Hello, good morning. A very warm welcome to you as we come together to celebrate our service of the Word on this, the second Sunday after Trinity. I'm so glad that you've joined me, and please do join in with the responses that will appear on the screen as we go through the service. Feel free to add a comment in that comment box too. It's good to know what people are thinking. So the pictures behind me are from our Messy Church family. They're pictures of their dads and granddads, uncles and father figures. And that's good to recognise today on this Father's Day. And also that we all come together as children of the same Heavenly Father, and it's good to spend some time with him now. So we will begin our worship this morning with that wonderful call to worship. Here I am to worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so high.
To give thanks to God, to talk to God, to listen to him and to hear his words, we'll just spend a moment of quiet and come before him now. We come from scattered lives to meet with God. Let us recognise his presence with us. As God's people we have gathered, let us worship him together. So let us pray, and today we have our collect for the day. Faithful Creator, whose mercy never fails, deepen our faithfulness to you and to your living word, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we come to that part in the service where we bring before God the things that are troubling us, the things that we've said or done that we're sorry for, knowing that we're speaking to a God that is full of compassion and has a heart to forgive us. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As sisters and brothers in God's family, we come together to ask our Father for forgiveness. You made us to be one family, yet we have divided humanity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You were born a Jew to reconcile all people, yet we have brought disharmony amongst races. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You rejoice in our differences, yet we make them a cause of enmity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we'll now join together to say the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. So now it's time for me to get behind the camera as we have our gospel passage this morning read to us by Lucy.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke chapter 14, beginning to read at verse 12. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a lunch or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your rich neighbours, for they will invite you back, and in this way they will be paid for what you did. When you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they are not able to pay you back. God will repay you on the day the good people rise from death." When one of the men sitting at the table heard this, he said to Jesus, "How happy are those who will sit down at the feast in the kingdom of God?" Jesus said to him, "There was once a man who was giving a feast, to which he invited many people. When it was time for the feast, he sent his servant to tell his guests, 'Come, everything is ready.' But they all began, one after the other, to make excuses. The first one told the servant, 'I have bought a field and must go and look at it. Please accept my apologies.' Another one said, 'I have bought 5 pairs of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please accept my apologies.' Another one said, 'I have just got married, and for that reason, I cannot come.' The servant went back and told all of this to his master. The master was furious and said to his servant, 'Hurry out to the streets and the alleys of the town and bring back the poor, the crippled, the blind and the lame.' Soon the servant said, 'Your order has been carried out, sir. There is room for more.' So the master said, Go to the roads and the lanes and make people come in, so that my house will be full. I tell you, in all of that, none of those men who were invited will taste my dinner. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. So now let's reflect on that gospel reading with a song which illustrates our calling well. The gospel message is for everybody to hear and to respond to, and we are commissioned to go out and tell others. This piece might not be familiar to you, but it will definitely get your toes tapping. It's called Vagabonds, and it's by Stuart Townsend. And then this will be followed by our sermon from Reverend Daniel.
The journey, come wait a while, stay a while, welcome you'll be. Come all you questioners, looking for answers and searching for reasons and sense in it all. Come all you fallen and come all you broken, find strength for your body and food for your soul. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place. With the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. The wonder of love and the power of grace. Come those who worry about houses and money, and all those who don't have a care in the world. From every station and orientation, the helpless, the hopeless, the young and the old. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place. With the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. The wonder of love and the power of and dreamers and schemers, and come all you restless just searching for home. Movers and shakers and givers and takers, the happy, the sad, the lost and alone. Come self-sufficient with wearied ambition, and come those who feel at the end of the road. And haters, accusers, abusers, heard and ignored. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place. With the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. Come to the feast, there is room at the table.
Shall we pray? Father, thank you for your words to us this morning. Lord, would you open our ears and our hearts so that we may hear what you would like to say to us. And Lord God, would you bless the words of my mouth. In Jesus' name. Amen. Once upon a time, I went to a wedding. And it was a wedding that was very special indeed. Now, I've been to more than a few weddings over the years, and many have been wonderful from beginning to end. But I've been to a few others where I've barely known another soul, except perhaps for the couple getting married. I'm not a wedding crusher. And this particular wedding was a bit like that. I actually didn't know the couple very well at all, and I wondered if I'd know anyone else there at the wedding. So I found myself in my head listing more than my fair share of reasons to turn down the invitation. Yet the bride and groom were quite persistent. "You must come," they said to me. "We will miss you if you're not there." So in the end, I attended the wedding. And you know something? I'm so glad that I did. So what made it so special? Well, it was this. The bride and the groom did everything that they could to make us feel valued and loved. Every single guest knew that they were valued and loved. Every one of us was made to feel like we really would have been missed if we had not attended the wedding. At the reception, we found a handwritten place name at each of our seats, and there was a gift waiting for us as well. And it was a gift that was hand-wrapped, sitting by our places, and each gift was unique to the person receiving it. And my gift was very personal to me, and it put a huge smile on my face. I was known by them, even if I didn't realise it. Now, providing over 60 gifts must have been expensive, both in time and in money. But the couple had evidently thought it was worth it. Providing gifts could also have been seen as showy, but it was evidently the furthest thing from their minds to show off. Instead, it was just about one thing. It was an act of sheer grace, and it was their way of saying, "We are thrilled you're here with us. We know you, and we care for you. And our relationship with you is valuable in our eyes." And to think, as I look back, I almost missed out with some silly excuse. And anyhow, I don't think either of them would have believed that it was going to take me all night to wash my hair. Now, in today's passage, Jesus is attending a meal, and it's in the house of a prominent Pharisee or teacher of the law. Yet we get the gist of what kind of gathering this is from a few verses before our passage. And we gather that it is full of people who are making a point of picking the best seats in the house. A bit like asking the bride and groom to shuffle along to make space at the wedding table. Now as Jesus watches this vulgar display, he is far from impressed. It is not just the guests that he is unimpressed with, but the host, the Pharisee too. Jesus looks around at the kinds of people the Pharisee has invited and wonders, is the Pharisee really hosting out of the generosity of his heart? Or is he hosting with an expectation of being repaid somehow? Is he expecting a rise in status or gifts or some other recompense for hosting this meal? The Pharisee seems to have chosen his guests very carefully indeed to make sure that this is so. And more than this, there doesn't seem to be a poor person among them. Where are those who are in need of such a meal? Where are those who would simply be unable to repay any act of generosity in any way? So Jesus tells the host a story, or a parable. It is a story of a far greater event, a banquet hosted by a certain man who invites many guests. And we get the sense that it's going to be quite a party indeed. Yet what do those who are invited do? Well, one can't sadly make it because, you know, he has bought a field and he wants to go and view it. Another has just bought a yoke of oxen, and so he's out of luck as well there because he needs to go and try them out. Now, both of these are lousy excuses. Who would buy, for example, a property, a house, for example, or an expensive item without first checking it out? I know that I wouldn't. The master sees through these excuses and tells his servant to go and invite everyone he can find, those who would never dream of being invited to a banquet, or indeed to the house of a Pharisee. The servant is to seek out those who are overlooked, who are seen as unworthy, those who are downtrodden and ignored, those who are suffering, those who feel there is no hope. And what, I wonder, will be the response to the invitation? They, of course, eagerly accept it. And so it is they who would enjoy the master's hospitality and grace. Yet there is still room in the house, and so the servant goes out onto the roads and the country lanes and continues to gather more and more people until the house is full. And as for those who were originally invited, for those who simply made excuse after excuse not to enjoy the master's lavish grace, well, they will never get a taste of the banquet. So this passage has a lot to say about giving and receiving, doesn't it? And it asks powerful and strong questions of us. Firstly, which kind of giver are we? What attitudes do we harbour deep in our hearts? Do we sometimes find ourselves a bit like the Pharisee? Do we find ourselves doing something for someone and wonder if one day we'll be repaid? Or do we give as Jesus calls us to, and as the Master gives, freely and without any expectation of being repaid, to all who are in need, without prejudice or exception? And what about receiving? Do we find ourselves too full of pride to accept gifts of grace? If we consider the story, the parable, once more, and if we imagine the Master as God the Father, the one who calls us in a sheer act of grace, are we too prideful to accept his invitation? Because without accepting the invitation of God the Father, without receiving all that he wants to give us, we are blind to doing what is good. We remain crippled by sin, and we stand very poor indeed in love towards both God and neighbour. And yet God calls us. And yet God calls us to humble ourselves. God calls us to face up to our need for his mercy and grace. And God calls us to accept and rejoice in how we have no means whatsoever, nothing at all, in which we can repay the lavish grace that God pours upon us. We are in poverty. And it is those who will humble themselves and those who will say yes to God's invitation who will take their seats at the Master's banquet. Yet we can find ourselves making excuses, can't we? We'll consider it tomorrow. We have all that we need. We're just fine as we are. Pride can stop us taking our seat at the banquet table. And it is pride that can stop us from having our eyes opened to the greatest and most lavish act of grace ever offered. Forgiveness, reconciliation, and new life bought for us through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It is truly a gift that we can never, ever repay. But that is okay. That is the point. Grace is always a gift. And at the same time, Jesus does ask one thing of us, and that is our very lives. And when we do give Jesus our lives, when we choose to follow him, when we choose to accept his offer of grace and forgiveness and new life, we find this amazing truth. Jesus simply gives us more than he ever calls us to give up. Such is the immeasurable grace of God. What an invitation. And Jesus does this because he loves us. Jesus does this because he knows us, he cares for us, and he sees our need. We are of immeasurable value in the eyes of Jesus. Now, for about a week or so, I considered sending a second gift to the newlyweds after the wedding as a thank you for a wonderful day. But then I stopped and considered what grace was. They wanted to give freely what they had given. They wanted me, and the gifts that they'd given me just to be received. They wanted me just to receive without giving back. So we are then left with some questions this morning. How will we choose to give? Will we give without seeking a reward? Will we give to those who have no means of paying us back? And will we lavish kindness and grace to those who are ungracious towards us? For freely have we received, freely we must give. And will we choose to receive? Will we choose to receive God's lavish grace extended towards us? Will we work to lay down our pride and humbly accept all that God wants to give us through Jesus Christ? Will we do that knowing that we cannot repay God's grace to us? Will we choose to accept God's love for us? And will we choose to take our seat at the banquet table? Let us pray. Father, thank you that you give to us as a measure of such lavish grace. Lord, we pray, would you help us to give as you give, to be generous towards those who are in need, and would we give without any expectation of reward. And Lord, help us to receive all that you have for us, that incredible act of grace in the life, death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Help us to receive the new life that you have for us. And Lord, with that gift, help us then to go out and to give and to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Do a work in our hearts, Lord, we pray. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we come together as one body, let us affirm our faith in Christ Jesus. We say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And we come to the part in our service now for our prayers and our intercessions this morning are brought to us by Heather.
Good morning, everyone. Dear God, thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your wonderful creation and all you have given us to enjoy. Thank you that you are with us and you will never leave us. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for your life, death, and resurrection, and for all, for the new life you give us. Lord, we know that nothing is impossible with you. We pray for our world, those places struggling with the coronavirus, and we remember those places where people are most at risk. Please protect them and bring an end to the virus. We pray also for where there is war and famine and injustice. We ask for your Holy Spirit to bring peace and justice and restoration, and bring hope and light. Bring hope and light to where there is darkness. We pray for those who are ill in our parish and ask for their healing. We pray for those who have lost loved ones and ask for your comfort and presence. We pray for those who are lonely or anxious or afraid and ask for your peace. We pray for those who are in need and ask for you to provide for them. Finally, we pray for us, your church, here in this parish. Please continue to build us up and to share the good news of Jesus Christ, and help us to help all those who are in need. Please also help us to pray big prayers, for we know that nothing is impossible with you, God. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Being made one by the power of the Spirit, let us pray together now with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Just before we have our closing prayers, a reminder that the Eucharist service will be at 4 p.m. this afternoon from the rectory, and we're going to have our final song, which is Will You Come and Follow Me? Please do join in.
Call your name. Will
Let us pray. Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son Jesus Christ has sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us in this mission and help us to live out the good news that we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service, and the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.